Today, we have a special episode of the Innovators Exchange, recorded live during the Futures Industry Association Conference in Boca Raton, with a select group of our clients as the audience. We have three guests joining us on today's show. Lee Hodgkinson, the Chief Strategy Officer of Saudi Tadawul Group, the stock exchange in Saudi Arabia. Isabelle Girolami, the CEO of the London Clearing House. And Mark Beeston, the founder of Illuminate Financial, a venture investment fund that's focused on financial technology. In today's conversation with our guests, we will be reflecting on their own journey of innovation over the past several decades and what this might mean for what lies ahead. This will be followed by a Q&A with our client audience. Thank you for listening. Hope you enjoy the show.
Super. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us this morning. I realize you guys have had pretty packed schedules, probably pretty tired of seeing lots of people at various drinks events. So do appreciate you squeezing us in and joining us today. We thought we'd do things a little bit differently today and try and leverage some of the experience we've benefited from running the Innovators Exchange podcast over the last 6 months. So we thought we'd try and keep it informal, try and keep it fun. I think some of the things that we took away was when we do normal recordings of the show, the individual stories really matter. Like often we all come here and you've got a title on your badge, it says you're from a company, it says you have a role, and everyone understands that's just who you are, right? You're just Christian from JUCO, you're just that guy. Like, and I think what we wanted to do here was hear a little bit more about the individual and the person, and the podcast has been a great way for people to tell some of their stories who are willing to share. I think the other thing we took away was, as consultants, we're guiltier than most of kind of always waxing lyrical about the future and trying to paint pictures about the future and what it will look like and how it will play out. And one of the things we've really enjoyed is going over the past, the relative recent past, what really happened when all those changes played out by the people who were there, by the people who did them, and is there something for us to learn from that? So hopefully this morning we're going to tap into a little bit of that. We've very kindly got three guests who've agreed to come up and have a bit of a chat. Different continents, different areas, different angles. And we thought that'd be a useful way to think about, well, what's happened in innovation over the last decade across those various angles and areas, and where might it go next? So thank you for humoring us. Hopefully it's a useful conversation. There'll be a chance for Q&A at the end. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce my first guest, Lee Hodgkinson. For those of you who don't know Lee already, Lee, do you want to do a quick brief intro on yourself?
Well, where do I start? So I've been around, I was saying you depressed me because I've been around, I think July the 3rd, this year is my 35th year in the industry. Which, so thanks very much for reminding me of how
looking
old
good for
I
it
am.
Still.
Yeah, so we'll see. But I did 10 years at the London Stock Exchange back in the 90s. Pretty much 10 years at the Swiss Exchange and then into the world of NYC Euronext, and then that became ICE, and then spun out Euronext, and then I ran OSTC, a big prop firm, for 4 years, and now I'm in Saudi for the last couple of years and thoroughly enjoying it.
Excellent, excellent. Well, I wanted to start by, when you think about that journey, what were some of the key pivot points or the key inflection points that played out, and what was some of, if you look back now and someone was to project onto it, oh, that was an innovation back then. What are some of those key ones you'd call out from the seats that you've been in?
So the first, it was interesting because, your question's got me thinking, right? So my first job in 1989 at London Stock Exchange was to carry the meeting minutes of pre-war and inter-war board meetings upstairs for a historian who was working for Sir Nicholas Goodison, who was running a book on the history of the stock exchange. And he showed me, he never really spoke to me, except on one occasion, and he showed me the board agenda for the stock exchange in that year. And he showed me, I think it was 1922 maybe. And the language was different, but the topics were the same. How do we speed up settlement? How do we deal with best execution? Things like that. 35 years on, we're still talking about the same. I mean, at my table, we've just been talking about best execution and fees. So in some respects, nothing has changed. And in other respects, everything has changed. And so in the spirit of innovation, I asked ChatGPT.
Love it.
What has happened from an innovation perspective in capital markets in my career? And it told me 9 things that happened. Electronic trading platforms, derivative explosion, securitization of financial engineering, algos in HFT, ETFs, hedge funds and alternatives, regulation, fintech, blockchain and crypto. It missed dematerialization. But I was saying to Paul, that's because it was so long ago. You know, the date doesn't go back that far.
Has its limits.
You know, exactly. The origins of Crest and Euroclear and Clearstream and all that stuff. But the big thing for me personally, you know, given my sort of, you know, time in European cash equities was Chi-X. And Chi-X changed everything. And if there's one guy I think that we should all, you know, really be looking at as a true innovator, is Peter Randall. Because Chi-X came and changed everything. Everything about it was innovative. Technology, pricing, you know, jump ball programs, equity investment from the banks, just, you know, the whole mindset. And it completely turned the world of exchanges in Europe on its head. Completely.
Yeah, yeah. Let me pick up on that last point there. You said in Europe, I guess you're one of the few, well, I guess one of the people now who's out in the Middle East spending time out there. How does innovation look when you're sat in different regions?
So I think it's a really good question. In Saudi, there is, you know, unparalleled vision, strategic intent, and capital to make things happen. The challenge for us at the moment is to bring into the country the competency, capability, and capacity to deliver. So that there are no limits in many respects. If you look at healthcare, if you look at tourism, it's a very, very digital nation. That the sort of levels of innovation and the acceptance of technology is far, far advanced than the West. But the challenge is, you know, we don't yet have a fintech ecosystem. How do we get that? You know, how do we get that? How do we build that? So when we're thinking about transactions and investments as the exchange group, and we're talking to PIF, who are our sort of 60% shareholder, it's all about how do we get businesses that bring, you know, capability to the kingdom or the region generally to help us really start to innovate. So that, I think, is the challenge.
Yeah. And looking forward, given everything you've seen over the years, I guess over those years, you'll have probably, when I go through that list that you just listed, how many of those are you actually able to see, able to control and influence? When you look at everything coming up now, AI, large language models, blockchain, there's a perpetual list that kind of sticks around. Leveraging your own experience, what do you think is going to play out, and what do you think in your seat and role you can do to influence, either making sure you accelerate, make sure you adopt, make sure you don't get disrupted as an individual?
Yeah, I mean, one of the challenges, I think, is that lots and lots of entities push technology solutions because of the technology. And it's never the technology that matters, it's what you do with it, right? So I get a lot of banks turning up and saying, you know, here's a blockchain solution that can, you know, give you atomic settlement. If I went to our broker community and said, you know, we're going to solve a problem that you don't have and it's going to cost $100 million, and no one needs that problem solved in a cash equity market.
Yeah.
So the real question is, what technologies are going to help us solve the big, you know, the big issues? And for me, that will be AI. And I think, you know, the AI revolution, you know, whether that's robo-advisory or predictive algos, you know, this is going to be the next stage. And the ability to deal with massive, massive data sets and turn that into actionable outcomes is really going to be important. The question is, how do you control that, to your point? How do you regulate it? Because inevitably it will be regulated. And how do you do that in a way that doesn't completely stifle and choke off innovation?
Yeah. Yeah, it's something that a lot of people are wrestling with right now, right?
Yep.
Trying to figure that out.
Well, I mean, the European Union today have announced their AI regulation, you know, and some things will be banned. I doubt that a sort of cyber AI bot that's intent on killing the human race is going to worry about a bit of Brussels legislation. But, I mean, why not?
Indeed. One last one just to wrap up. One, the show, we always get people to share one of their personal learnings or lessons they've taken away just for the wider audience? I guess from your own journey, is there something that you'd draw on and be willing to share?
Yeah, I mean, so 35 years old is, you know, 70% of the Saudi population is under 35. What I tell all of the young people there is failure is inevitable. And don't get too excited about your successes. Don't get too depressed about your losses and your failures. You just got to roll with the punches and stay in the game and value your self-worth more than your net worth, because there's always someone that's got a bigger boat or a faster Ferrari.
Love it. No Ford, no Fiat Puntos out there, though, yet.
I must admit, I sold my sports car and got there after some hefty speeding fines. I got an electric car. So, yeah.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for joining
us, Lee. Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah.
We're running a little bit of a Jonathan Ross style approach, so Lee's going to shuffle on down whilst I ask Isabelle to join us.
Thank you, Hiten. I'm glad I got the memo to wear trousers. This helps.
Thank you for joining us, Isabelle. Do you want to just start with a brief introduction for those who don't know you in the room?
So I'm the CEO of LCH Limited. I'm going to quote maybe something. I mean, the highlight for me of the last 2 days has been somebody who's running a big exchange who asked me, he said, what's your deal? Where are you coming from? And I said, well, you want to know what I've done before LCH? He said, no. I want to know where you were born. And I said, but why? He said, because that's going to tell me who you are. The rest is just what you've done. That's it. So I thought that was interesting. So I was born in Corsica. And I've worked for the sell side for most of my career until I joined the London Stock Exchange Group 4.5 years ago.
Excellent, excellent. And what changed when you flick over to the sell side, you join a big infrastructure, any big changes in how it feels, what you do, perspectives?
It's massively different. I mean, it's like walking to the other side of the mirror in a way, because you know FMIs when you work for a bank, but you don't really realize what an FMI is when you work for an FMI. So we are extremely regulated. My head regulator is just here. And we are very key to the functioning of the financial market. So we have a sense of purpose and a sense of being resilient and being good at what we're doing, which the banks have also. I'm not saying they don't. But to some extent, the banks tend to do the same thing, all of them, right? So they compete along the same way. We have very distinct niches where we are very, very large, and we don't really have a huge amount of competition in the niches that we operate in, which makes us carry more responsibility, I would say, and definitely more pressure.
So that's an interesting angle to jump in on then, because I guess I'd invite you to opine then on what does it mean to innovate when you have such a core structural role to play in the market?
We don't innovate for the sake of innovating. That's the first thing I would say. For me, innovation is interesting for the outcomes and what I can get, not really to have a tagline about the fact that we innovate. And what I'm looking for is what can make us more resilient, what can make us stronger, more efficient, deliver more value for our members and the financial community. And I'll give you a couple of examples. I mean, we use AI. We use AI in cyber protection. We're starting to use AI to provide better access. We have a very complicated rule book as a CCP. And to provide better access and faster access for our member community to look for things within the rule book, we use AI. Being on the public cloud for us is innovative. It might not be innovative for a lot of market participants, but for us it is, because it means working with a third party for a big part of what we do, which is the whole management of the infrastructure of the business. So it's quite significant for us, and it's a journey we've been on for the last 2 years, and it's going to take a few more years before we complete what we want to achieve there.
Yeah, I think what you said at the start, that is so powerful, right? Don't innovate for the sake of innovating. And I suspect there are many people in the ecosystem who ought to probably adopt a similar philosophy.
I mean, we definitely can't afford to... be leading from an innovation perspective. I don't think we should. Again, it should be driven by what we want to get out of it and by the outcomes, and definitely not by being a trailblazer on the innovation side.
Yeah, it links back to what Lee said, right? When you look at those board records from 1929 or wherever, when the core function and the purpose remains beautifully consistent, right? Yeah. Execute, settle, stability.
For sure.
And sometimes there can be a distraction around, oh, if there's something new and shiny, let's do it for the sake of doing it, rather than, as you say, to enable the objective that you're setting out to do.
With a scale, that's different, though. I mean, I would say that I'm sure there's lots of similarities to the 20s, to the 1920s, but...
I wasn't there.
Okay, no, I'm saying.
Not that old. 1930s, really, you know.
But we are much, much bigger. I mean, the rate of expansion is phenomenal. So we need to be in a position to, again, safely process a gigantic amount of transaction, which keeps increasing every day.
And just given relatively recently we went through COVID and all of the various lockdowns and restrictions, what did you learn through that period running, you know, such a critical and scaled infrastructure? What was some of the things that kind of stood up and worked that people may have historically beforehand thought weren't possible in that situation?
So what was amazing for me was how much people got together to make it work. We had the lowest level of tech incidents ever during the whole of the COVID period.
Wow.
All working from home, because people were working endless hours to really make sure that everything was ticking as it should. And so there was a sense of a community and of really, and again, a sense of responsibility of making sure that everything continued to work as it should. And it was remarkable. I mean, it was the most incident-free period of operating ever. And we don't tend to have incidents, so it's very rare anyway. But there was absolutely nothing.
Wow!
For a year. So that was that was really impressive.
Enlightening. Thank you for sharing. Wrapping up with your own personal biggest learning through your career, something that you'd want to share for other people to benefit from.
I liked what you said about the young people and the fact that they have to learn to fail. And I think that's definitely, I think, very, very key. And I talk to young people lots and very often. I find them a little bit too concerned about their career path and how to go to the next level and what they should do. And there's a sort of almost huge worry that they have that they might not be able to break through, I think my first advice, just to continue along what you said, is to tell them not to worry so much, that things will happen if they're good at what they're doing, and it's okay to do lateral moves. They shouldn't be always obsessed with doing the next level up, and take it as it comes and learn from people around them. But be a bit more relaxed. I think I see so much anxiety among the young people. Maybe it's more competitive, and the environment is a little bit more competitive than when I was young, for example. But I don't think that having that sort of huge fire to be promoted every year necessarily is the right goal to pursue.
Very wisely put, and something that feels very topical right now as people try and manage their talent groups. But thank you so much for being with us this morning, Isabelle. Finally, I'd like Mark to come and join us. Can we do similar, Mark? Do you want to give a quick intro on what you're up to now before we go into mini-history on you?
Following in the footsteps of giants. I got to pick up on something Lee said at the start. I didn't feel old when I turned 50. I definitely think turning 50 is better than not turning 50. But when I turned 30 years in financial markets, then I felt old.
Yeah, exactly.
So I'm Mark Beeston. I'm the managing partner and founder of Illuminate Financial Management. We are a purely financial services technology focused VC. currently operating out of three different funds, and very much in partnership with the industry. We have 9 strategic LPs, some of whom are in this room, invested in our most recent fund. And over my 30 years in financial markets, I spent 13 years at Deutsche Bank, where I was a fixed income derivative trader and COO of their global rates and global credit businesses. I was very fortunate to be there in sort of Deutsche's sort of massive trading expansion. A rising tide floats all boats, so right place, right time is definitely an important lesson along the way. And I left Deutsche and went to the entrepreneurial side of the fence. I joined the exco of Creditex at the same time that TA Associates invested in them, giving me my first exposure to the financial sponsor side of the business. And I set up their post-trade processing business, which at the time was T0, now Icelink Credit. Learned a few lessons there, which we'll come back to, no doubt. We sold that to Jeff at ICE in 2009, and then I went to ICAP, where I ran post-trade and information for 4 years, led their first round investment into a small company called Acadia, and did the acquisition of TriOptima, which I was chair of for 4 years, set up their CVC before leaving to launch Illuminate.
Wonderful. What a journey. So let's pick up on that. Life at Deutsche versus life now, you know, at the heart of a, you know, a VC fund. Like, what does innovation look like when you were sat in the middle of a trading floor versus now you're kind of working with a bunch of solution providers who are trying to sell into that side? What's the?
Yeah, it's really funny. I've changed all my answers, so get ready for this. again, standing on the shoulders of giants and just listening to what went before. I think the industry rhetoric around innovation for the last few years has been totally flawed, right? So much, you know, is kind of driven by, you know, what do we tell the board we're doing about innovation, right? You know, oh, we've got a lab, we've got a blockchain thing, we've got this, right? And I'm actually very pleased about what's going on in the innovation landscape today. Is much more about applied innovation rather than what I would call ivory tower innovation. If I go back to those times, you don't necessarily realize how important the stuff that is going to turn out to be innovation actually is when it's happening right in front of you, right? I'm old enough to, you know, I started running the cross-currency swap book at Deutsche on Lotus 1-2-3 WYSIWYG, right? You know, and then we had Excel, and then we had a C++ library, DB Analytics, which, you know, like, those changes were the fundamental drivers of being able to massively expand the derivatives market, right? What's the single biggest innovation that I've seen? I think actually it was when I walked over to Oldgate sometime around 2000 and signed a piece of paper signing Deutsche up to, you know, be one of the first institutions into SwapClear, right? I don't think any of us, like, you know, we thought it was important at the time, but I don't think any of us could have looked forward 25 years and been like, oh my goodness, how important was that going to be?
So that's really interesting, isn't it? So I pick up on that. It sounds like what you're describing is just through the immediate course of business, you're making some of these changes and decisions to fulfill the objective. And then when you're looking back and storytelling, then you'll say, oh, that was innovative, that was a change. But at the time, it feels like you might not even know you're innovating. And if you're innovating for the sake of it, as you say, it's a bit of a potential distraction rather than staying on course for what the business needs you to do.
Yeah, I think it's it comes back to what you were saying as well about kind of, you know, careers, right? I think we're all of a generation where you look behind you and a career is what you see in your wake, rather than you look in front of you and you're always kind of, you know, kind of fully positioning for it. And I think the same is true of, you know, of some of these, of some of these, you know, innovations and changes. I remember when I was first out raising our first fund, and you go and talk to professional investors and they say, if I'm going to back you as an emerging manager, you know, how long is this problem going to exist for, right? You know,
like, tell them Lee's story now, right?
That's no, exactly. Well, this is actually really important. And you know, as a younger version of myself raising a first fund, I didn't really have a particularly good answer to that. But my answer really was, look, the mess we're in today, if we're allowed to call it a mess, is a function of the expansion of the derivatives industry since the very first PC was put under some derivative trader's desk in the mid-80s, right? And, you know, here we are 35 years later, and, you know, the PCs have gotten faster, and then we went to big gray boxes from Hewlett-Packard, and then we went to, you know, on-prem cloud, and now we've gone to, you know, like, this is not 10 years to fix, right? This generational refresh of infrastructure in our highly regulated mission critical, hugely, you know, compliance aware world is a, you know, it is a generation. It's a 25, 30 year journey.
But bringing it back to now, given that you must have a bunch of early stage solution providers coming, pitching to you for funds, like, I guess what are the themes that you see, given what we just talked about, not innovating for the sake of innovating, what themes do you see that get you excited when some of these new companies are coming to see you?
Yeah, well, so apologies for those people in the room that have heard me say this before, but, you know, having bet my career on what I saw as a need for generational change in financial markets infrastructure, again, to Lee's point, driven by the macro operating environment post-crisis rather than technology for technology's sake. Here I am 10 years later, and I'm more excited about it than I ever was, because what we've seen is these other massive generational change imperatives that you're all dealing with every day. So there's no new information here, right? The institutionalization of digital assets, it's coming. Right, doesn't mean everything TradFi is going on to digital asset rails, but there's a lot of stuff going on to those rails over the next decade, and it's really exciting. ESG and carbon transition, right? Like finance, institutional finance sits at the absolute heart of that. Consumers in the street are expecting the financial system to be leaders, you know, and change agents in that space. The rise in importance of private markets, alternative assets, wealth, the infrastructure that supports that. And then, you know, those are sort of our four sort of macro themes that we get really excited about. And then across all of that, of course, you have, you know, enterprise technology as it's targeting financial services. And, you know, obviously AI is the current, you know, most buzzy one. I think it is, you know, a whole separate conversation. It's, you know, adoptability is very, very different to blockchain. It doesn't require a wholesale jump of the institutions onto it, you know, we can start using it individually. So there's just a huge amount of exciting stuff going on.
Sounds awesome. Excellent. Great seat to be in and see that all happening. Before I move to Q&A, I guess, Mark, your biggest personal learning across that journey that you'd want to share?
Yeah, I'll pick up on the young person, but the young person I'll refer to is myself. You know, when I went from being a Deutsche Bank to being a very small vendor, bringing a whole new solution to space in the post-trade processing space, that really kind of defines everything that we do at Illuminate, because I learned two really important lessons. And the first one is a horrible moment of self-realization, politely described over breakfast. I have a bar version if people want to hear it. Oh my goodness, I said to myself, was it really this difficult to sell me something I desperately needed when I was that managing director at a bank, right? And the answer is, yes, it was. The answer to those of you that are small vendors in the room, it still is. The second lesson was the thing that actually made us successful along the way was nothing to do with cutting edge tech. Everything to do with having fit-for-purpose technology, but an industry network to take it to with warmth and credibility to give it a chance of becoming an adoptable solution, right? And so, you know, that really underpins our sort of industry long-term relationship and partnership approach, and, you know, was lessons hard won or hard learned.
Sounds like lessons that will stand people in good test of time for the decades to come as well. Thank you for sharing. I'm going to move to Q&A, but take questions from the floor. For one or any of them, fire away.
For anybody, Mark, maybe first. If you weren't doing what you were doing right now, Illuminate, like 10-year, what would you be doing? It can't be just a different fund. Fund one with a different name.
I think those of you who know me know I'd probably be working for my car dealership in Northamptonshire. Which is actually the first business I founded that's still going, some sort of 25 years later.
Anyone else want to pick on that question?
I would run a restaurant. I love to cook.
Would it be French?
No. too rich. I think it would definitely be more Italian than French, I think.
Well, I would say I'd be annoying my wife because she was the biggest proponent of getting people back to the office in COVID after having me at home for a while.
Thanks, Brad.
Yeah, it's not as fun a question as Brad's, sorry, but it's a simple question about competition. Isabelle had some wise words about competition in the job market. Mark, you alluded to some of it. But just pushing a bit further, in my job, I'm always being asked by clients to forecast competitive structure over a 3 or 5 year time period. Nothing new about that. But with a much longer lens, the 30-year viewpoint, are things getting more competitive in fintech? Where is competitive structure going to end up in a few years' time? It's really difficult for people like me on the ground to sometimes see which way things are trending. But, you know, if we're here in 5 or 10 years' time, which I hope we are, or maybe, how are things going to look different? Specifically, I guess, in the world of FMI and to the service providers, to the broker-dealer and asset manager community.
Can I jump in on that? So I think, you know, when we think about the fintech space, if you go back a decade ago, if you thought fintech, you actually thought consumer, right? You know, we had all these companies that we can now kind of consider incumbent fintechs or, you know, consortium fintechs or what have you, right? But when people thought, you know, early stage fintech, they were really, you know, they were really thinking about Revolut or Monzo or you know, payment rails for remittances. They weren't thinking next generation market infrastructure. I think what's really remarkable is over 10 years, you know, the enterprise side of fintech has kind of gotten larger. But here's a truly terrifying statistic in terms of how much kind of competition for time and attention there is out there before we move back to the bigger organizations. We've made 40 investments. We've seen 7,400 companies, right? And the pace of our pipeline, you know, if we'd had this conversation 3 years ago, you know, before the market reset, I'd have said we see, you know, 150 companies a quarter, 600 to 700 companies a year. We saw 900 companies in the last half of last year, right? So competition for time and attention, funding is like nothing I've ever seen.
I would add a sort of geographic dimension to the competitive dynamic. Our world, you know, particularly in capital markets and financial markets generally, is still largely a US-centered world. But I think that's changing. And I think that, you know, if you look at a lot of the innovations and a lot of good innovators have come out of China, they've come out of India, they're coming out of the Middle East now. And I think we have to, as an industry, get much better and more tuned into what is coming out of what would traditionally be described as emerging markets, because these things operate at scale. I mean, I think the FIA released something the other day about equity options volumes in India. I mean, exponential isn't the word for it, you know. And I mean, look at things like TikTok, you know. So I think we are, you know, undergoing a shift in the sort of competitive landscape, which is enabled by the advances of technology in markets that are huge. And I think that's going to, you know, that's going to have an increasing effect on those competitive dynamics. And in Saudi, you know, we see as many Chinese and Indian firms competing with, you know, firms like yours and others. And they're superb, and you know they've got scale. So I think there is a bigger picture dynamic coming, and you know, the world is going to look very, very different, much quicker than it has done in the past, in my opinion.
I have a slightly different view. I think that the barrier to entry to a lot of what we do is very high, very high, and I don't think it's getting any lower. And rightly so, okay, because there's a concentration of actors in the FMI space, which means that they need to be immensely regulated and they need to be very protected, or they need to protect their business and the business of their members. So I see, and maybe I'm being complacent, I don't know. So it's interesting for me to hear both your views, but I don't see somebody coming in and just taking the space of one of the major FMIs and revolutionizing everything at scale. But I see a lot of the innovation coming into the space and helping the FMIs be better at what they're doing, delivering more value, integrating some of the solutions that are being proposed. But we saw also with FTX, like a couple of years ago, it was going to revolutionize the whole of the industry, and at least created a lot of angst among some of the exchanges. We saw what happened with that. So, but I don't know. Maybe it's a view which is a bit complacent.
No. I mean, I don't think it's complacent. I think the point I'm making is, lots of these competitive dynamics don't want to participate in Europe. So our fastest growing set of geopolitical relationships with China, and you know, with India, Brazil, we're not interested in replicating or participating in what's going on in Europe. In cash equities in Europe, no one's made any money for 15 years. So I understand what you're saying and agree in the context of competing it within the European dynamic, but I think it's a bigger play that's cutting that out. And I think, you know, my big challenge in my career in Europe was always trying to convince the authorities in Brussels, you know, to think about the debate that America got right. Do you want a European champion or a champion of Europe? It's still all about DG Mark and internal. And whilst that's going on, there's a whole world out there that's just bypassing it. People who want to raise money coming to Riyadh now, they're not going as much to London, in my view.
I think you can look at, again, at the world of, you know, real world infrastructure, where we all kind of know that, you know, there are countries that kind of were considered behind but totally bypassed one generation or multiple generations of telecommunications infrastructure to jump straight to 5G with none of the legacy baggage. And so I think you're right in terms of, you know, like the asteroid is not coming tomorrow. Nobody's about to launch a, you know, new, you know, OTC derivative clearing platform that's highly regulated and is going to have critical mass tomorrow. But I think there are an awful lot of, you know, changes going on around the fintech universe coming out of the world, you know, of digital assets, of blockchain infrastructure. You know, I remember when I did my first FCA qualifications, and you know, I don't know what it is today, but you know, you had to remember, when is the Hong Kong Stock Exchange open? I was a fixed income derivative trader. I've never needed to know when the Hong Kong Stock Exchange was open, but I do know now why it was only open a certain amount of time, and it was because, you know, like as with all of these groups, it's because you need time to settle the trades. But you don't need time to settle the trades anymore if you're on, you know, the next generation of infrastructure. So, you know, I'm not saying death by a thousand cuts, but there's a thousand changes coming that are going to end up with, you know, either they'll either enable the incumbents or they will change the incumbents over time.
That's a great point. Amazingly, at the Saudi exchange, we had to move to T3 settlement. We had to slow it down from T2 to be accepted into the international environment, only to now be told we're going to speed up again to wow. T2. So I think you're right. You know, there's a lot of change there.
Well, look, it's great debate to have, and I think Mark needs a shout out for dropping a Taylor Swift line in his response. You'll figure out which it is later. I just want to give it out for, we'll carry on with the others, but can you give a round of applause for Isabelle? Any other questions for the rest of the group?
Don't ask us a Taylor Swift question, Paul.
Can you spot the quote?
I can't, actually. I'm still thinking about that. I guess my question's around innovation across the entire industry. I think Warren Buffett once famously said, you know, the problem with banks and financial services firms is often they're too big for their management. And Isabelle made the point about, you know, big firms getting bigger. Are we nimble enough as an industry? You mentioned, Mark, about it doesn't get any easier to sell into larger firms, and as these firms get larger and larger and more concentrated, as an industry, and we're all participants in it, it would be a worry if we weren't nimble enough as an industry to be innovative. Does that concern you at all?
I think it used to concern me, and what I realized over time was, you know, actually it's okay, right, as long as the actual actions of the industry match the rhetoric. I think we got in a position in the innovation landscape where the rhetoric was out of sync with the reality of operating in this market, right? I tell my team, much to their annoyance all the time, that they're not technology investors, which is obviously a farcical statement. Everything we invest in is technology. But it comes back to Lee's earlier point, right? You know, we are old-fashioned business problem collectors and old-fashioned business solution investors. It just happens that everything is technology. The technologies that we take for granted as consumers, right, are necessarily going to be way slower to be adopted in institutional finance. They have to be. We have to be up 100% of the time. We have to be compliant 100% of the time, right? And
I was meeting with one of the heads of one of the big cloud companies yesterday, and I said, you know, where are we on our, you know, industry cloud journey? This is not exciting new technology. Are we generously 20% of the way through that journey? And he said, I don't think we're double digits. And it's okay, all right? It's okay, you know, as long as we keep kind of moving forwards, but not just kidding ourselves with this innovation theater, the labs, the West Coast corporate tourism, et cetera, et cetera. Don't get me started.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of nonsense spoken, right? I think, you know, the problem with sort of measuring agility is it's relative, you know. So I think it can feel, you know, at times we're not agile as an industry. But actually, when you look at that in, you know, compared to times gone by, we are. And it is being enabled, I think, by the new technologies. So, I mean, BMLL is a great case in point. What you can do in the cloud with that level three data now wouldn't have been possible 3 years ago. And you know, the agility that that brings. But I think it's such a fast-paced world. We've all got so many priorities, so many demands. It can actually still feel quite stodgy. But I think generally, you know, this is, I mean, and again, it's fantastic being here, I think, in this conference and today. Because you realize, you know, how much brilliance and drive and, you know, dynamism there is in our industry, and that will keep propelling it forward, I think.
Super. Any other final questions from the group?
I've been here 20 years at this conference. You know, we all go way back. Google, AWS, and Microsoft were not here at all for a decade and a half. You know, there's a megatech play here. Sean Park's video in 2005, if you can find it, on eBay and Amazon and NYSE and all these things coming together. Now, the differences today, I would say, are these big network effects and these connections where a ripple there just butterflies around the world. So competitively, the megatechs are in our world. I compete with them pretty head-to-head on a day-to-day. And while a natural monopoly, like a clearinghouse where there's only one, that's a totally different competitive dynamic. But most of this conference does not exist in a high-walled, highly regulated. And the megatechs themselves are a huge hyperscaler play for all of us, but they're definitely a competitive threat if you take a 10, 20, 30-year generational view of things. 3 years ago wasn't possible. 5 years ago it is. There's many gatekeepers. Europe is definitely on their front foot trying to control, given they have very few assets in the large technology space and are taking lawsuits and regulations basically at it. So how do you think about the large megatechs and competitively, you know, what does that dynamic look like? Not in 3 years, but in, you know, 10 or 15. Are we ceding too much ground?
I think you're setting Hiten up for a really great subject for a whole nother podcast. I don't think you can consider all three of the sort of megatechs around the space the same. Like, you know, like you definitely compete head on with at least one of them because they are a product company that just happens to have a, you know, massive cloud business, whereas, you know, the others are actually massive cloud businesses rather than product companies. So, you know, they're not all created equally. I don't think they actually want to be in, for the most part, they don't want to be in highly regulated businesses. The wallet share here is so enormous. I think the stat is something around $280 billion of cloud-enablable wallet share, three of them to go after. It actually makes an awful lot of the businesses that we do look, you know, subscale. So, you know, I don't think they actually want to eat that lunch. There's so much kind of going on at the foundational level, but, you know, never say never. I look forward to hearing that podcast.
20% of my OpEx is cloud. Cost. Competitive.
Yeah, I think the thing that we observe is just there's a bit of this uncertainty. Everyone wants to talk about having conversations with them, hanging out with them, enabling elements, but I don't think anyone can fully understand that balance of cooperation, right? Like there's that moment, oh, it's great that we can announce a big tech partner because it shows we're at the forefront of that element. But if you follow that logic too far forward, some questions we see in some of the boardrooms be like, well, we then have our own tech organization that can operate independently. To Lee's point, when I'm traveling the world and you speak to people outside of Europe and North America, like, so hang on a minute, our whole critical infrastructure is going to run on something run by the Americans. Like, yeah. how does that feel in a geopolitical environment? And so there is suddenly, I think the realizations aren't fully through. And I don't know, Lee, given where you sit in the world now, whether how you'd respond to that.
Yeah, I mean, my general feeling is you know, as we've seen in the last 20 years, the boundaries will blur and we will have these sort of multi-dimensional relationships. You know, once upon a time, the exchanges would never compete with Goldman. And, you know, now I think your partners on one hand, competitors on another, service providers on another. And I think we'll probably shift to that dynamic. But there, it is a very good point you make, Hiten, about the element of control in these areas. And I think in the, you know, the developing world, there are more concerns today than there were in years gone by about some of these services. Because years ago, you know, there were servers and you can, you know,
press
control
the off button.
Those, so you can switch them off and people can be arrested by regulators. And there was, you know, sort of tangible things that the authorities could do. When that's in, you know, cyberspace, those controls are less clear. So I think there will be a control dynamic in a lot of these things as well. But there is an air of inevitability that, you know, we're entering a new era of, you know, enabled by technology that would just perpetually blur the boundaries, I think. I think crypto is a fascinating example. When I was at OSTC, I made, and I, in fact, I bumped into some of the traders that used to work with me a little while ago, who thanked me for barring them from trading in Bitcoin a few years back. That's now, whatever it is, $45,000. So that was one of my better decisions. And we were worried at the time of not losing traders to other firms. We were worried about losing them to their own personal account trading. Wow. Because it was easier for them to trade in Bitcoin and make money than it was to stay and work with us to trade on regulated markets. That was a problem we didn't have 5-10 years ago. And, you know, if I look in Saudi, everybody trades Bitcoin on their phones at every dinner party you're at. So it's a whole new world. I mean, it's just a whole new world and a whole new environment.
Yeah.
That has broken, you know, those traditional relationships and boundaries. And I think more of that will continue.
Thank you all for joining us, making the time. Thank you to Mark. Thank you to Lee for coming on. And we'll catch around. Thank you so much.
Thank you.